Hey, Tim, what's the plan for our show this time?
Well, Paul, we've got an interview with comics creator Tom Peyer. He's the editor-in-chief of Ahoy Comics, and he wrote stories for the Batman 66 comic book series.
Holy Batman analog! He's also the writer of The Wrong Earth.
Right, The Good Earth. I read it in high school.
No, you're thinking of Pearl S. Buck.
Wait, wasn't she the co-founder of the band R.E.M.?
Wait, that's Peter Buck. Oh, you're getting me all confused, Tim.
Never mind that, old chum. We've got an interview to conduct.
To the Batpoles!
Welcome to the Batpoles, where we're living in fear of meeting our doubles from Earth Omega.
Nice.
This is Tim in Tokyo with my brother Paul in Hanover, New Hampshire.
I'm gritty and grim.
Our theme this time is by Bobby Valentin, titled Batman's Bugaloo, not to be confused with a completely different Batman Bugaloo that we played two episodes back.
And not to be confused with the boogaloo that keeps getting mentioned in the right-wing media, but let's not go into that.
Yeah. Or with the bugaloos, the Sid and Marty Krofft show.
Right.
Okay, now, this Batman Boogaloo, or Batman's Boogaloo, is from the album A Young Man with a Horn, which Amazon, Wikipedia, Discogs, and Allmusic all say came out in 1965. But obviously there's something wrong with that.
Nope.
Unless the sheet music for Hefty's theme was leaked to Bobby Valentin before the show was broadcast.
Nope. didn't happen.
Perhaps there was a version of the album that didn't have Batman's Boogaloo on it. So, a little history. Bobby Valentin was born in Puerto Rico in 1941, moved with his family to New York in 1956. And as I mentioned a couple episodes ago, New York was the birthplace of boogaloo music in the 60s, which came from a mixture of Latin and African-American musical influences. Wikipedia says the name boogaloo was probably coined in 1966, and if that's the case, that's another reason to be suspicious of this album being dated to 1965, because it has the word boogaloo on the front cover.
Mm.
1966 was also the year of the biggest boogaloo hit in the U.S., Big Bang by the Joe Cuba Sextet, which I was going to listen to and didn't get around to it. Because I'm sure it's on YouTube like everything else.
Of course it is.
And of course, Valentin had just turned 25 in 1966, and Wikipedia names him as one of the very young leaders of the movement, some of whom were still teenagers. The movement spread to Puerto Rico and some Central and South American countries, but by 1970, it had pretty much burned itself out. And as we mentioned at the top, this time we're talking with comics writer Tom Peyer, a guy who knows his Batman 66 and other versions of Batman as well, and he wrote some stories in the Batman 66 comic book, which we've talked about some of his stories. We've kind of stalled on our presentation of or review of the comic, but a new series of The Wrong Earth Night and Day came out recently, and we didn't know about it until all the issues had come out. But
and we also didn't know about an entire series called Dragonfly and Dragonflyman, which tells like backstories of both of those characters.
I had actually read that. And I think, I guess I just forgot to mention it to you, but
yeah, I found it completely by accident on Comixology when I bought the 6 issues of The Wrong Earth Part 2, or The Wrong Earth Night and Day, as the series was titled.
Yeah. Okay, so without further ado, here's the interview. All right, we are on Zoom with Tom Peyer. How are you doing, Tom?
Very well, thanks, Tim. How are you?
I'm okay. So, of course, Tom is doing the Good Earth, the Wrong Earth, and some other series also that I haven't read yet from Ahoy Comics, and did some writing on the Batman 66 comic series and many, many other comics.
Yes, dating back to the Vertigo days, right? You were an editor for Vertigo back when Alan Moore still roamed the earth as a comics writer. Am I right? Or was it a little bit after that?
Yeah, he wasn't working for us anymore. But Neil Gaiman, Grant Morrison, Peter Milligan, Jamie Delano. We got to work with some pretty good people.
Yes. Giants roamed the earth.
So I was noticing, though, that all the Ahoy series kind of come out in chunks. You'll have a six-issue series, and then it's gone for a year and a half, and then another six issues comes out. But why is Ahoy doing it that way?
Well, it's a way to mix it up with different titles without having to publish 80 books a month, which we're too small to do. And it's also a, well, before the pandemic anyway, it was a a fail-safe against late shipping, where we would try to schedule things so that there was a lot of time to get a book done before we release it. Now, of course, everyone's life turned upside down in 2020, including mine. I probably wasn't watching the calendar as closely as I would have in recent years, but in previous years, but back on track. And on-time shipping is very important to us.
I see.
Right. Now, you're the editor-in-chief of Ahoy. Is that correct?
That's right.
How many comics are you publishing, like floppies, are you publishing in a given month, would you say?
It could be four. It could be three. Even five sometimes. Five would be the absolute limit. Because of the pandemic, we've had some lighter months, too. We're getting back up to full speed again.
I'm a little ashamed to mention this, Tom, but I did not realize there was a Dragonfly and Dragonflyman comic with that title that came out as a kind of sidebar to, or not a sidebar. I mean, in a way, it's like a necessary second series.
It's a prequel, basically. It shows them on their own Earths. You have some good reading ahead of you, my friend.
I devoured them just today. I hoovered up the entire first series with Peter Krause and Russ Brown. Is that right? The artist.
That's right.
Maker. And the artwork is remarkably like the work for Wrong Earth. Even though I don't think there's any like Jamal Igel copycatting going on, but there's some good synergy between the lining, the line styles of both artists, and just the overall look of each book.
And then all three of those artists have just tremendous skills. I mean, they have real perspective and characters with weight and real proportions and anatomy, and everything's right, you know. They're all accomplished.
Absolutely.
So the second series, Night and Day, just finished. So my confession, well, and Paul was in the same boat, neither one of us realized this was coming out until the publicist contacted me and like, this is the last issue of the second. What? I mean, I look at the new comics every Wednesday, and I was just kind of missing it, I guess. Or did it come out on Wednesdays?
We're the worst Ahoy customers ever.
Well, you, my friends, are going to have to follow at Ahoy Comic Mags on Twitter. You'll get the lowdown on everything coming out.
Okay.
Okay. Then I have to look at Twitter.
Yeah, you don't have to look at Twitter. You can also subscribe to our free email newsletter.
Ah, that sounds more my speed.
It's a bit.ly, you know that site? bit.ly/newsahoy.
Ah, okay.
All lowercase.
Okay.
That sounds, sounds like a relatively painless alternative to Twitter. I like that.
Do you have an endpoint in mind for the story? I mean, how many more six-issue minis are we getting?
Well, you know, I put a lot of space in between the first two so we can go back. Like, I wanted to move it beyond the point where they're trapped on each other's Earths. but I wanted to leave it so that we can go back and tell stories about that time, because that's like the greatest time.
Right, because it's a year later, so.
Yeah, so, and then there'll be some lag time before the next one. So I think I know when the whole thing ends, but I could change my mind as I get into it.
Because twice you fooled me. I thought, oh, this is the end, right? And then I get to like the last five pages. Nope. It's not the end.
No, we're not ready yet.
So now the overall arc of the original Wrong Earth series was that the Dragonfly Man of Earth Alpha switched places more or less accidentally with the Dragonfly, that is the kind of Frank Miller's Dark Knight version of Batman to the Dragonfly Man's Adam West style Batman, or the Silver Age Batman perhaps would be a better way of kind of giving it an umbrella term. Mm-hmm. So we've got Earth Alpha, we've got Earth Omega. Earth Alpha is the Adam West, so to speak. Earth and Omega is the Frank Miller Dark Knight, so to speak.
Yeah, it's like the constitution of Earth Alpha is the comics code. Earth Omega, they've lifted the comics code fairly recently, so they're really going overboard.
Right, like Marvel, right. In 2001, 2002, going like way too far. Yeah. I remember right. Those books.
Right. The kid gloves have been, completely taken off. So what is there a designation for the Earth in which the character I think of as the main number one who appears in Night and Day, the number one who's actually causing these mirrors to open up in both Alpha and Omega and dump all of the like nuclear, the environmental waste. Is there a designation for that Earth? Because if there is, I seem to have missed it.
Yeah, that's Earth Zeta.
Zeta.
That's Zeta. Okay, got it. All
named
right.
After Adam Strange's Zeta beam.
Excellent. Excellent. You seem to know a lot about comics.
It's all all the science I know is from old comic books.
Okay, so, and part of what I'm doing is a little expository for listeners who might be a little bit, who haven't, caught up with the series yet. But the reason that Tim and I got interested in The Wrong Earth was immediately because of the kind of the Adam West versus Dark Knight aspect of it. And I hope that's not pigeonholing what you're doing too much, because I know that's a beginning point, but by no means is it the end point, and it's not a container for what you're trying to do with these two versions of the characters, but it's a catalyst, I guess. Would that be fair to say?
Yeah, and I'm not that precious about it. I wouldn't get offended at that description. I do like to point out too that the Batman TV show in the 60s in particular was a very honest portrayal of what comic books were at the time. It was not these Hollywood Sharpies just stomping all over what we love. They read it and absorbed it. And you can go back and read a Flash or a Green Lantern or an early, early Thor and just feel the same things. Like they're all that funny. And they're all that like up until, I guess, the late 70s, early 80s, every superhero upheld the status quo. And then after that point, every hero kind of aspired to sticking it to the man, which is kind of the opposite. And so there are a lot of heroes that fit both characters' descriptions. And if you're thinking of Batman when you read it, well, you should be, even though my lawyer probably wouldn't like me to say that.
Well, I was wondering, what was sort of the... I mean, when I first heard about this and picked it up, I assumed that two different Batman analogs switching places was the point. But as I'm reading the second series, I'm thinking it seems like it's more just a delivery vehicle for some other things that you wanted to say. So I'm wondering, what was the first idea that you had that you built everything else on top of for this series?
The first idea I had was taking the campy old hero stick it to the man, new hero, and make him switch planets. That was the first idea. And then there are other ideas in it, and there are like themes to the stories and points to the stories that are separate from that. But those all came from, not from planning, but from sitting there writing and being in the company of the characters, being in the weeds with them. And that's when the best ideas would come, because I was getting to know them more and more and more. Mm-hmm. And it became apparent, for instance, you know, maybe halfway through the first series, that the thing that really connects them is their emotional attachment to kid sidekicks. And for better or for worse, in terms of, you know, sometimes it's tragic and sometimes you hope it's not.
Well, they also have some other things in common. Like we saw late in the first series how they both ended up, you know, when their backs were against the wall, they relied on their money to get them out of it.
Exactly. That was the thing. You know, we've been showing how different they are, And then we were able to have that scene that shows they're the same guy.
Right, and you've been playing up that very issue when it comes to, say, well, you know, in little ways, like when the dragonfly of Earth Omega says, you know, I can check out the Earth Alpha dragonfly man's, you know, I can look at his codes, I can look at his images, I can, you know, dig into his computer in ways that he didn't give me access to, because it's effectively my computer too. It's my system as well, right?
They all, every version of him that we've met so far has thought of the same passwords for their computers, so they all can go in, do whatever they want.
But yeah, that realization that they're in some ways, you know, exactly the same person, you know, maybe just give or take a few vibrations off from one another, is, I think you're probably digging into the sense that, you know, the Batman that we know, the Frank Miller Batman, even the Grant Morrison Batman that was kind of developed out of the Frank Miller Batman and then kind of, you know, flipped on its head a little bit, that the origin of all of that is still the Dick Sprang Batman, or the, you know, the 40s and 50s Batman, especially the Silver Age Batman, that, you know, there's that's how close we are with these characters, is as close to, you know, as close as the Batman of 1966 was to the Batman of 1960, or, you know, the Batman of 1971 was to the Batman of 1966.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the real DNA for me is that first year without Robin. Those stories are, you can go back and read them all the time. There's something just so fine about them, even though they're so crude. You know, they really do what they mean to.
Right. I wonder if you could dig in a little bit further into your comment about the 66 show really getting Batman right from that era. You know, back when the 89 Burton film was hitting it big, it became fashionable for Bat fans to diss the 66 Adam West series as too naive and too cute, or just too snide about comic book heroes and their fans. You know, not unlike many of Bill Joe White's Batmania readers back in the 1960s, who were complaining that the 66 show didn't treat the comic right, treated the readers like idiots or jerks or, you know, stupid for
made
enjoying
fun of the characters.
Yeah, made fun of the characters. And my original question was, what's your response to that charge of the 66 show being either cute and prettified Batman or smug and snarly, a kind of snarky takedown of superheroes and their fans? You've already started to answer that, but I'd be interested in hearing more about your take on that.
I think of those as like shame-based responses. That's shame-based comics. These are, they make me think that, you know, certain fans have always wanted grown-ups to pay respect to them for reading comic books and not to put them down. Now, it's been many years since anyone put anybody down for reading a comic book. There was a time that I can remember where you needed to not care if you were going to like take one out on the bus, you know, and you're kind of an adult to be seen with a comic book. You needed to not care what people thought of you very much. But those times are long, long gone. But the shame lingers. I think the shame-based fan DNA is heavily present when, like, you know, Ben Affleck puts on the Batman costume and shoots a bunch of guys with his tank. And it didn't help that for like 40 years after Batman, every article in a newspaper about comics, the headline started "Pow Zap Bam."
I don't think they've stopped doing that yet.
And there were, you know, there were a lot of readers who really felt like people are, you know, people are going to think I'm stupid for reading these. They should know how smart and intelligent these things are. And therefore, if a comic book does something funny, then it is betraying me. And if a TV show of a comic book does something funny, it's really betraying me because everyone will see it.
But the flip side of that is, you know, if a comic book is showing Batman using a machine gun and, you know, mowing down 15 guys, then my comic book is showing the world that I have grown up and that my, you know, my comics have grown up. And so there's maybe a kind of reaction formation in that, you know, embracing of the violent Batman as the real thing, you know, then, you know, we'll show them all.
Mom, look, comics are for grown-ups. This is a sexual assault in the Justice League headquarters.
Ay-yi-yi-yi.
We had the same reaction. Well, and so kind of tagging on to that point, so yeah, these days we've come back around to the 66 show, and you know, there you're seeing a lot of kind of homages to it, but what we've been noticing is that sometimes those become sort of oversimplified or dumbed down versions of Batman 66, like the what was supposedly a Burt Ward type Robin in the Lego Batman movie, but he was much more airheaded than Burt Ward's portrayal. And you know, they might make fun of the Adam West Batman's squareness. I was happy to see in the second Wrong Earth series how Jordan Reese, Stinger 2 of Earth Omega, shows admiration for Dragonfly Man, calling him a great man in spite of his squareness. So I'd like to hear you talk about that.
Well, he is a great man. I mean, he lives by his beliefs, and he's brave, and he goes out and helps people. And you can think of him as a buffoon because he'll lecture you if you cross the street against the light. Mm-hmm. But look, he gives up. Look at all he sacrifices and all the risks he takes. What he said is what I believe.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's see. I had something else about the Wrong Earth, and I'm going to call it the Good Earth again before we're done here.
We've got Pearl S. Buck with us this evening, ladies and gentlemen. it's a seance. We're using a Ouija board as well.
Now, obviously, these are not technically Batman 66 and Frank Miller Batman, but the kind of takeoffs on that. And those two series were set in particular time periods, but I was interested that everything in The Wrong Earth is set in the present day. It's not like it's 1966 or something. Well, we don't really know what year it is, but what was your thought about kind of the time period of The Wrong Earth?
Yeah, I didn't want to introduce... It almost felt like a distraction to me if Dragonfly goes to Earth Alpha and he can't have a cell phone. You know, or they don't have video cameras or
GPS shows up in this show.
Yes, GPS shows up in it. It seems like I'd rather just concentrate on the personalities and the attitudes of the worlds than have all these other differences that don't mean the same thing. So that was a conscious choice.
Are you tired of fanboy comics podcasts? Looking for a show that really appreciates the comic storytelling medium and how it works? A show that looks at comics from any genre and anywhere in the world, comparing the storytelling techniques of different creators in different comics cultures, with manga, newspaper strips, European comics, and more, discussed alongside mainstream U.S. comics. A show that includes talks with well-known creators like James Robinson and Dan Jurgens, and with less famous creators that you really should know. And hey, we'll even critique your comic. If you're looking for that show, then you're looking for Deconstructing Comics, and it's right here at deconstructingcomics.com. Also available in iTunes and on Stitcher. This is Tim saying check out our show on Wednesdays. That's Deconstructing Comics.
Hello, I'm Ken Holzhauser, and if you're looking for something new in comic books, may I recommend my newest comic, The Quick and the Dad, a love letter to the DC, Marvel, Archie, and Harvey comics of my youth. This comic has everything. It has spaceships, dad jokes, alien invasions, time travel, supervillains, and so many bad puns. Hopefully you'll like it. It's the cutest comic you've never heard of, and it's available today in print and digital from IndiePlanet.com. That's The Quick and the Dad. Join that other dynamic duo, won't you?
Am I right in thinking that the temporality of the two Earths is a little bit off from one to the other? Stinger seems, well, it seems as though, you know, one Stinger is still young in Earth Alpha, but that same Stinger passed on, right, mm-hmm. in Earth Omega. And it seems as though we may be a little more advanced in years, like
the Earth
maybe
Zeta,
10 or 15.
Yeah, the Earth Zeta one is older.
Is older still, so yeah.
Right, right.
Yeah, he's Night Sting.
Night Sting, yeah. I love that.
Of course.
Perfect.
Right, grown-up Dick Grayson, right?
Yeah.
But, yeah, there is a, it's kind of like the old Earth one of them, too.
Yes, of course.
20 years difference, but in these cases, it's...
Was there any thought given to having each Earth have its own unique art style? Because they're all drawn in basically the same the same style. But did you consider having them look different?
We did that, and this was Jamal's idea. We did that with the coloring. If you go to Earth Omega, there's like a slight red filter over everything.
Mm-hmm.
That you can really kind of tell by looking at the coloring.
Okay.
You're on, but in terms of, yeah, you know, giving one a big square jaw and the other one, we wanted them all to be people, just like trapped in each other's world. So we want kind of a straightforward approach to the drawing.
Yeah, that could have gotten complicated to have like draw one character who was drawn in a completely different style from everybody around him when he was in a different Earth.
Yeah, it would be hard. Although they do keep their same costumes and no one ever notices, which is, I was thinking about the magnificence of the old TV show Green Acres and how Oliver Wendell Douglas, played by Eddie Albert, would be out working the fields in his like 3-piece suit. That's great cartooning.
Right, right. Yes. I'm reminded of how everyone in the Scooby Gang wore exactly the same clothes from season one to season infinity.
The guys on Dragonfly wore the same clothes because they would shoot episodes out of order.
Right.
Different episodes. They never knew what episode they were in. So they're always dressed the same. And it's the same at the Daily Planet, too.
One thing I wanted to ask you, Tom, before I forget about it, since we were talking about Earth Zeta here, there's mention, I think, in issue 3 of Night and Day, number 1, the kind of main number 1, is telling both of the dragonflies, Dragonfly and Dragonfly Man, who are kind of standing in, they're basically... chained up in that kind of moment from the Matrix where everything goes white, it reminded me a lot of the moment where Morpheus is telling, you know, Neo about, you know, everything that the Matrix is, and, you know, everything goes completely white and they're just sitting there in these two chairs. That seemed like a similar kind of blank space where history could be told without any distractions. But as they're talking, one of... Number One's comments is kind of a throwaway comment, is that in this world, in his world, nobody ever stopped making things. We just kept producing. We kept producing the future. Whereas in these other worlds, in both Earth Alpha and Earth Omega, everything, you know, kind of started to suck, and then you were told that none of that ever happened, that there was never a moment where, you know, we were pumping money into the social system and trying to sort of, you know, bring everyone up to the same speed. Do you remember what I'm talking about? there's a, I mean, you must remember. I just hope I'm not getting it wrong because I don't have it in front of me right now.
I can forget anything at the drop of a hat, believe me.
But I wonder if that was a way of just thinking not necessarily about the way that progress is represented in comics, but rather progress, that there is a kind of forgetting. Maybe you're talking about nostalgia for, you know, better times. Like, you know, people have a kind of nostalgia for the 50s, even if they didn't live in it, because they imagine it's the 50s of Father Knows Best and Leave It to Beaver, rather than, you know, a very difficult time for a lot of people, you know, labor crises and all kinds of other, you know, strident, difficult social issues, the Cold War and all of that. But it seems as though number one's notion is that, you know, my world is the world where we never stopped making the world more utopian, whereas these other worlds kind of, you know, stopped at a certain point, and then there was decay. Is that a theory of history or a theory of nostalgia or a theory of comics and the way that comics represent, or the way that we think about history through comics, perhaps?
Sure. Yeah, well, the other point he made was that the other worlds didn't just stop putting money into the public good, but they put the money into war.
Right.
And war preparation and war materials and what we laughingly today call defense. And so it wasn't so much of a nostalgia thing. It was like more of an alternate history. What if we didn't put all this money into war, and we put it into the general welfare? What would that be like?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how far you've gotten into the Wrong Earth, Night and Day, but it ends up being a pretty corrupt place anyway.
Well, it does. Yeah, it's got so much waste. It doesn't know what to do with it all. And so it dumps it in other worlds.
It's a place that's utopian on the surface and dystopian if you peel back a layer.
Right. Mm-hmm. Whether there's war or not, whether there's, you know, investment in the military for its own sake or not, there's still a cost.
There's other ways to suck. Yeah.
New ways to suck. That was a Spider-Man story about 10 years ago, wasn't it? I have a question more about the just thinking about the Wrong Earth as a kind of different lens on the 66 show, since the 66 show is obviously what brought us to this podcast in the first place. How did the villains for the Wrong Earth, that is for Dragonfly and Dragonfly Man, take shape for you? They're kind of analogous to Batman 66 villains in some ways, but there aren't any direct parodies of any specific villains. What logic did you use to develop these, you know, baddies like Pilgrim Progress, for example, whom I utterly adore? What I love about him is he seems like he could have been a Batman villain if we just turned the whole show about 14 degrees to the right. And yet he's not. You know, he's not any, in part because there wouldn't be any, you know, there would be no slap in the face to any particular religion on the 66 right. show. But nevertheless, just the parodic kind of, you know, taking a character from some profession and ratcheting up, you know, the evil possibilities of that character. I'm just trying to think through the logic of the various villains you came up with and how you were able to kind of nuance them without just flat out ripping off the Riddler, the Joker, and the Penguin.
There's one that's kind of like that was directly inspired by the Riddler, and that's Triviac.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. His riddles are, the answers to his riddles are always like entertainment trivia. So there's him. There's a villain in there, Toreador, who for most of my life I thought that it was wrong that Ricardo Montalban never played a bullfighter villain on Batman. To me, that was the clue that we were on the Wrong Earth. Because on the right earth.
And, I love it.
But other ones are like, well, there's Granny Oakley, just so there's cow
person. Ma Parker.
Ma Parker mixed with Shane, I'd say.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And there's the chef, the French chef one, Chef Escargot, who was not a Batman villain, and they didn't do a French chef villain, but they could have. They could have so easily. They would just take one thing, you know, Colonel Gummit with stamps. Just drop one thing on somebody. Bookworm books. Bookworm's such a great villain.
Yeah. And you did some remarkable things with him in the 66 series, too, I thought.
Thanks. I love Bookworm. Sorry he didn't do more.
I was sort of shocked in The Wrong Earth that both versions of Dragonfly, Dragonfly Man, they don't seem to mind punching women. What was up with that?
Do you mean Granny Oakley?
Well, or in that scene where Dragonfly Man is in Earth Omega and he puts on that black and white striped prison costume and goes into the bar and is punching villains saying, you know, oof, pow, whack. And there are some women among those villains that he punches there.
I don't remember him punching any women in that. Could they have been in the crowd watching the fight?
No, I remember specifically. There was this woman who had, like, really, really low neckline in her costume that you can see him punching there.
All right. I must have been thinking about something. But I forget what it is. I just wanted to address the sexism and culture, or maybe I was. Golly, I don't know. I had it. See, I would, because you could imagine Dragonfly Man having to give himself a long lecture before he punched a woman.
Yeah, right. Yeah, certainly Batman 66 would.
But he was at a very low point then too, and it was the fight. It was like he was in this severe state of hopelessness because he was trapped in this miserable world. And then when he found a bunch of bad guys to punch, it just lifted him again. He was like, this is great.
Okay, so I warned you I was going to ask you this question. We've talked a lot on this podcast about the ground rules of Batman 66, assuming that the show had a quote-unquote Bible, and we're not quite sure if it actually did, but... if it did, what would be some things you would include in the Batman 66 Bible?
Yes, what Troy McClure would call the do's and do not do's of Batman 66.
Well, the prime directive, of course, is defer to Batman. Always. Batman is just the greatest, smartest, most wonderful person who ever lived.
Oh, yeah.
He's always right. The best thing for me, and this is not an answer to your question, it's a sidebar, but the thing in Batman that just keeps on giving, no matter how many times I watch it, is the performance of Neil Hamilton. So great. And he is just so starry-eyed whenever he sees Batman. And Batman is his boss, and he is Batman's toady. He plays it so well. I just admire him tremendously.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Tim and I were just enjoying. We did an episode on the three Mr. Freezes on the show, and we spent a lot of time with Otto Preminger, and we just adore the moment where the GCPD is stripped bare to its essence when Mr. Freeze freezes out police headquarters in the commissioner's office, and Commissioner Gordon is reduced to saying, "Batman, help!" It's like, finally, he's just telling it like it is. None of that gobbledygook, none of the alliteration. He's just coming right out and saying what really matters, what matters to him, what matters to all of Gotham City's police. Help us, Batman, we can't do it.
The Chandelle episode, he calls Batman and Batman's not there. And because Bruce and Dick are camping up in the woods, and when he is calling Batman, when he picks up the bat phone, he's calling him, he puts on this beautiful, hilarious show of being like smug, and Batman will handle it, and he like bounces on his heels, clearing cough, and he just is going to talk to Batman and everything's fine. And then he finds out Batman's not there, and his world falls apart. and go watch it tonight. It's magnificent. It's only 2 minutes.
And Neil Hamilton may have just been phoning it in for his paycheck, but he certainly knew what note to hit, didn't he?
I don't think he was phoning it in at all. Stafford rep, on the other hand.
Yeah. But Neil Hamilton was a professional from way back. So
They're all great. They're all great. I love them all. Mm. One thing I've always enjoyed thinking about is how Adam West and Burt Ward are older than their characters. And they really got around it by surrounding them with a cast of senior citizens.
That's true.
Yes, indeed. That is certainly the case.
Yeah, Batman's a young whippersnapper compared to Burgess Meredith or Tallulah Bankhead or...
Or the regulars. All the regulars are old, aren't you?
Yeah, yeah. Yes. Alfred, Aunt Harriet, Gordon O'Hara.
Right, right. They look as vital as they can possibly get against that that contrast. Reading through the intros by various members of your supporting cast, the intros to the collections, I was really struck by, just discovering that Dragonfly began life as Watchdog, right? Mm-hmm. This was supposed to be Watchdog and Spike. Was that the Stinger's name? And I know that you, I don't know the context, but I do know that you didn't want to walk on another creator's idea. At least that's what I understand from the context. And so you changed it to Dragonfly. What did you lose and what did you gain for the Wrong Earth concept when you left Watchdog behind and moved over to Dragonfly and Dragonfly Man?
We gained everything. It was all gain because... The dog stuff was a joke on top of a joke. It didn't need it. It would have been to have like a straight dragonfly. Nobody makes fun of dragonflies, and have them in there with a straight face made the thing 100% better. And that was Jamal's doing.
Oh, really?
It was his friend who had the dog comic, and he's like, "Let's not do that." And he actually he had just been on a trip to Japan and. That made him think of dragonflies because they have lore about dragonflies there.
Oh, interesting. Interesting. So what's some of the lore that you've been able to tap into?
I always remember this slightly wrong, but in the broad strokes, I'm right, which is in Japan, dragonflies are symbols of like grace and courage or traits that are as good as those. There's something kind of physical. But in Eastern Europe, they're like the devil's insects.
Oh.
So it fits characters perfectly. You have this sweet meaning in Japan and this like evil, horrific meaning in Eastern Europe.
So it's not actually that far from the different connotations of bats, depending upon the culture.
Yeah, that's right. So in the next volume, I hope I can get to it where they argue about the meaning of dragonflies.
Mm. Mm. Let me bring up the Bible question one more time. Did you have any other thoughts about that? We had noticed in the 66 comic book that you may be better than the other writers, maybe just instinctively knew that Batman never addressed Robin as Boy Wonder on the show. He would introduce him as the Boy Wonder, but he'd never call him Boy Wonder.
You know, I was just reading that. I went to your site and I downloaded a few of those scripts, like with Lorenzo Semple notes on them and stuff. And that's there. He wouldn't call him Boy Wonder, but there's no explanation. And I wondered to my grave what the explanation is. And if I didn't have him call him Boy Wonder, I am relieved because I didn't know that rule consciously.
Mm.
I've known it unconsciously. I mean, I always would go, every line I wrote for that, I would go through it in the actor's voice and really try to match it to the best.
Yeah, maybe just because you never heard him call him, hey, Boy Wonder, we need to go. Then you just, it didn't occur to you to have him say that.
Say Robin or Chum.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Well, so I would love nothing better than to like sit down with Lorenzo Semple's rules and with explanations for them, but it'll probably never happen because he probably didn't write them down.
Well, one very interesting rule that Tim and I concocted or reconstructed based on some of his notes to the King Tut script, the initial King Tut script, is that Robin just doesn't complain. Robin doesn't whine. He doesn't get the way that little kid pre-New Look Batman Robin would complain about not being allowed to get involved in a fight or being left home because he had a cold or something like that. The Dick Grayson slash Robin of the 66 show, Semple would not allow Robin to be anything but a good soldier.
Very well. That,
yeah. Gosh, and yes, Batman, you're right.
Now, did you find, after he left the show, did you find these rules breaking down? The show getting less
some of
disciplined.
Them. I don't think
kind
that
of around
one.
Kind of around the edges. That one never broke down, but there was hardly time for Robin to have a character during season 3 in particular, because there were so many characters and single episodes of 22 minutes apiece instead of the arcs. There was almost no time for characterization to flourish any longer at that point.
That show makes me so sad in a way, because it just it's like entropy in action. It starts out so great, and then by inches and inches and inches, it becomes terrible.
Yeah, and by season 3, you've got, you can see the staples, the stapling the scrims to these flimsy frames that only cover about a fourth of the set.
I know, which is mostly covered in black curtains.
Yep, yep. Even if there's a second floor, there's just a door at the top of the stairs.
Oh, where did the money go?
Yes, well, Dozier, it's a joke that we tell quite often.
Dozier, yes.
D-O-U-G-H-Zer was doing his best to, keep things going on a very slim budget.
You feel bad about season 4, but then it could have been just the two of them sitting behind a desk for an hour.
Yeah, it could have been a radio show. It would have been, great. The sets would have been better. Yeah. We just have to imagine them.
Season 1.
In your colleague Jeff Parker, in the intro to the collection of Dragonfly and Dragonfly Man, said something that really struck home to me, and I wondered if you had what your reaction to this was. He says in the intro, conventional wisdom credits the dark side of super comics, largely originating with Alan Moore's and Frank Miller's seminal 80s works like Watchmen and Dark Knight Returns. As great as those were, a lot of what they inspired provided diminishing returns, weak world building that reveled in shoving the reader's face in the ugliest scenarios possible. Do you agree with that? What is meant by weak world building in this case? I think I know, but I'm going to defer to a comics creator here instead of imagining that I understand it myself completely.
Well, instead of building the environment and imagining what would come from it, just think of the most shocking thing you can think of.
Mm-hmm.
And do that. And it's not even just comic books. I mean, a lot of television has become that, where you watch this era of peak TV, which I love. A lot of it, however, is let's think of something cool or cruel or amazing or horrifying and rationalize it later.
Mm-hmm.
So, which is the opposite of world building.
Well, it's interesting, too, that, it's Miller and neither Miller's Dark Knight nor Moore and Gibbons' Watchmen seem like unrealized worlds to me. In fact, they're quite full worlds, but it's the comics they both inspired that have the difficulty with coming up with those worlds and taking issues to their, conclusions. Like, when I think of Rorschach or, the comedian in Watchmen, I think of, like the kind of quasi-Ayn Randian, Ditko character really taken to a particular conclusion. Like, what are the ramifications of a hero like this with this ideology living in an actual world where, there's Nixon and Watergate in Vietnam? And that felt fully realized to me. I think one of the complaints that people may have had about The Dark Knight Strikes Again, the second Dark Knight series, is that it kind of took in the world that it had created, that Miller had created for the first Dark Knight series, and re-injected it with Dick Sprang and Jack Schiff and, 1950s and early 60s, early Silver Age DC stuff that was just whack-a-doodle. And people seemed embarrassed by that, but it was another version of, the kind of world building that Miller had done with the first series. He was just trying to sort of re-inject all of the goofy stuff that he enjoyed from the 50s and early 60s of DC into the world that he constructed for the Dark Knight. So, you know, there are possibilities within that kind of world building that don't always please the fans because they're building up a world that's not quite as palatable to a fan that's expecting a certain kind of grittiness or, you know, what have you.
Well, you can't, to your first point, the drawback of having a great transformative comic book is it's going to have 1,000 lousy imitators. And that's what happens in every case.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
There's no avoiding it. And I have probably written some of the lousy imitations. But, and your other point about the second Dark Knight series is, to me, the point of that series was always, you can't write a whole series the night before it's due.
Well, look, I'm not trying to defend it. I have to admit that the thing that I found unpleasant about that was about that series was not like the violence. It wasn't the goofiness. It was just that it didn't seem as though he was plotting out more than a page and a half in advance anymore. When Miller, you know, with his Daredevil stuff and with Dark Knight, the first Dark Knight series, he was like, he had the whole thing, and Ronan as well. He clearly knew what was going to happen at every moment in the story, and I didn't get that feeling from the second Dark Knight book. It was like, you know, what's going to happen next? I'll draw myself a picture, and I'll make that into the next part of the story.
I never, like, go on record talking about not liking someone else's comic book. But
fair enough.
I felt like, I will make an exception in this case because I could just feel the contempt bleeding off it. I don't think he penciled it. I think it was done quick, and I think it was done for a buck.
On the 66 comic, so the stories in that book often went far beyond what was possible in terms of the budget or the technology available on the show. But it could be argued that going beyond those restraints that the show faced made the comic feel less like the show. So where do you come down on this?
I love Jeff's stories. I think he's great. And I love what they were trying to do, which is give the thing a budget because the TV show couldn't have it.
Mm-hmm.
My stories did lean more toward trying to duplicate the series without really changing anything.
Mm-hmm.
I think I wrote one story that would have had a big budget that had the Archer in it.
Mm-hmm.
Because they take over Central Park or something. The wall.
Right.
But I was, even the TV show, when it started to get less liturgical, like when they changed the opening intro to part two so that instead of all these panels, you just see them like laying there in the trap and the narration. I hate that. I want everything to be the same as it was. Well, 1966 when the Riddler came along.
Yeah. Well, you know why they changed it.
Why did they?
So because they found that a lot of people were skipping part one to watch Lost in Space on Wednesday night and then just getting up to speed watching the summary at the beginning of part two, and they were trying to incentivize people to watch both parts. So they'd only tell you where it left off and nothing that happened before that.
I had the opposite experience because I never saw how they got out of a cliffhanger on Lost in Space.
Right, because Batman would preempt the first half of it for you.
Right. Tim and I were a little young. We, you know, neither of us existed. Well, Tim existed, but he was only a year old when 66 Batman got started.
It was pretty messed up when they put those two shows on opposite each other. It was not a good thing for kids.
Yeah, and they're both 20th Century Fox shows, for crying out loud. It's cannibalizing themselves.
It was bad.
Well, the networks were king at that time. The production companies were just, you know, bowing and scraping pretty much. It was a real buyer's market back then.
Were there any story ideas you wanted to use in the 66 comic, but you didn't get a chance to?
I want to do something with Black Widow and Wall Street.
Hmm.
But chance. But I hadn't really thought it through that much, but I figured it would be, I could make some funny points with a Wall Street story.
Well, there's some very funny points in Wrong Earth regarding the economy, regarding the fact that there's a banker instead of a police chief sitting next to the commissioner. We commented on that at some length when reading the first, when reviewing the first Wrong Earth series. That it's fascinating that we always had this sense that that Adam West Batman was all about upholding property rights.
Oh, the best that ever happened to millionaires in Gotham City. I mean,
yep. So to have a banker as one of the two authorities to whom Batman and Robin, or in this case Dragonfly and Stinger, or Dragonflyman and Stinger report, was kind of perfect. We thought.
Thanks. And his Chief O'Hara is the mayor.
Right.
Dumb Chief O'Hara.
So, some of the questions I got from listeners through the board, and someone was wondering if you would be interested in sharing any of your Batman 66 comics scripts online.
Oh, I would probably wouldn't have a problem with that. I'm sure I still... Gmail is my filing system. They probably still have them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, I don't have a problem with that. I want to facilitate that. I could dig them out.
Okay, cool.
That would be very kind.
I wonder, so the Batman character these days, do you think that Batman is somewhat hobbled in public perception because he's a rich white guy? Or if so, how could Batman creators adjust to that zeitgeist?
I don't know. I haven't seen a lot of complaints myself about that. Although I personally I like that he's a millionaire who can afford the Batmobile and the Batcave and stuff. I dislike that he's a billionaire who runs the city now.
Mm.
To me, it's just too much of a muchness that he's so important in both of his identities. So I'm not a fan of it. Other people are, and they say it's nice to have Bruce do things in the story for Bruce to do. But I don't care. Yeah. I don't care about Bruce Wayne. I care about him.
Well, you just have him be the head of every committee in town, like Adam West.
That was pretty fun. Yep.
Yes, the racing commission, the boating commission.
The surfing commission.
The boat racing commission.
The annual millionaire's banquet.
Yes, yes, let's not forget that. And the beauty contest, of course, the droit de seigneur and all that.
Just kind of in general, I was wondering if you had any thoughts on whether or when or how the pandemic should be portrayed in fiction. Like if you pick up a current comic now, you don't see anybody wearing a mask or getting vaccinated or getting sick or anything. And maybe just people don't want to see that in their fiction right now. But it's at what point do you think we might see references to it in comics?
That's a good question. I haven't really thought about it myself. I really love comics for escapism.
Mm-hmm.
I have plenty of news and nonfiction books and all kinds of stuff like that in my life. I don't really need Plastic Man to weigh in. I'm a huge fan of escapism, so I probably don't have a huge appetite for him. For a pandemic story, but it'll happen. It all happens. I mean, ever since Green Lantern, Green Arrow, everything's represented eventually.
Mm-hmm.
And there's probably nothing wrong with it.
Yeah, you're going on about the rights of the Green Man and the Orange Man and the Plaid Man, but ... actually, all I want to know, Tom, is what does Plastic Man think about the mask mandate? That's the only thing that matters to me. Okay, kidding.
I drifted away.
Just kidding.
I got so bored listening to him. I don't even know what he thinks.
Okay. Paul, do you have any other questions?
I don't think so. We're running up to an hour, and we don't want to overstay our welcome. There are millions of other things we could ask, Tom, but I'm just really grateful that you decided to hang out with us on Zoom for a little while and chat and listen to our crazy, badly worded questions. Well, mine. Tim's questions are worded fine.
Your questions are all good. Good myself. It was good. It's nice to meet kindred bat fans.
Mm.
You guys know more about it than I do. I still watch it. I will always watch it in my life, and there are things I key in on that I love and notice. But when I went to your site and see what other people know about this, I felt tiny.
It is intimidating. I've experienced that myself looking at the message board.
Well, I think your comment, Tom, about figuring out what the characters were really about by simply writing them, you know, by not just conceiving of them and trying to, you know, set up a kind of, you know, perimeter around the characters and the two worlds, but rather living with the characters, writing them, figuring out, you know, what it means to be so optimistic and how that, you know, plays out in interactions with others who are less optimistic or even more optimistic. I mean, that I think that goes for the way that we think of the Wrong Earth books as well. We think harder and differently about the Batman 66 series when we read the impressions that you're, you know, taking away from it and the ways in which you're developing the, you know, the so-called goody two-shoesness or the, you know, the uprightness of Batman is, you know, it informs us in new ways by putting those, you know, putting that behavior into different directions and, you know, putting it in new paces that we're not used to. So it makes us think about the show differently, and that's a real gift.
Well, thank you very much. That's very nice of you to say.
Are you addicted to classic TV shows? Did you spend the 80s sitting in front of the boob tube? Then join us for TV Tangents, where we examine television of the 20th century with barely any contemporary context. Visit Shout Engine, Apple Podcasts, Google Play, or wherever you get your podcasts, and look for TV Tangents.
Coming up, Burt Ward talks about Batman shooting locations, and we read your mail in the Bat Inbox. Help support To the Bat Poles and all the Deconstructing Comics shows with a monthly donation to the Deconstructing Comics Patreon page at patreon.com/deconcomics. For just $2 a month, you get outtakes from every To the Bat Poles episode. Plus, Paul and I make bi-weekly videos for all patrons, usually featuring a TV trivia quiz. Our most recent video featured questions about Nancy Walker, Charlie's Angels, the Electric Company's Skip Hinnant, and Batman. Patrons can also vote in polls for which Bat topic you'd like us to cover next. Further perks at higher support levels, including the right to have an ad for your own project on the show once a month, and hours of podcasts on the early issues of The Amazing Spider-Man and the Marvel Cinematic Universe. So go to patreon.com/deconcomics and select the level of your monthly donation. Thanks for listening, and thanks for your support.
All right, you're on with Robin. What's your question?
The question is, were most of the episodes shot on location? Where were they shot, at Universal or Paramount? Or?
No, we worked for 20th Century Fox, but because they were doing so many series at the time, we were relegated over in Culver City to the Desilu Culver lot. And that's over on Washington Boulevard. It's now changed names a couple times, but we shot there, and occasionally at 20th Century Fox. When we did the outdoor stuff, we usually did it at Rancho Park because that's right across the street from 20th.
Uh-huh. And who was it that designed the made the song? You know, the initial Batman song.
Neil Hefti.
Who was that?
Neil Hefti.
Neil Hefti.
Yeah, real talented guy.
Bat Inbox. After we recorded the mail last time, there was one more comment on episode 163, the Phantom Pharaoh script show, on the all-seeing, all-knowing 66 Batman message board. That's kind of a heavy metal Ewok there.
I think I might have burped in there somewhere. Apologies.
This is from Batwing Hornet. Another winner, guys. Tim, your "he's too busy serving on every committee in Gotham City to chase any skirts" had me straining not to make an appropriately timed Andrew Cuomo reference.
Oh boy.
About the Playboy trait, purposely removed from the 66 Bruce Wayne, It's odd that Semple did not want Wayne to keep that side of his personality. It would have added more color to the character and a more balanced life other than being a human rule machine, living only for his committees and tutoring Dick on his various school subjects.
Yeah, that's an interesting point, although it would have pulled away from Semple's interest in making Bruce Wayne completely square.
Mm-hmm.
Just as, you know, as as square as a square in Plato's version of heaven. So it might not have served at least that vision of the character very well.
Right, yeah. I mean, yeah, he couldn't be square and a ladies' man. It wouldn't work. He'd have to be one right. or the other. Although, I mean, I think if he had, as High C was saying, too, in when we read last time, if Batman had been a little bit cooler, it might not have, the show might not have drifted towards making Batman dumb as a rock in some of the later episodes.
Yes, if only Charles Hoffman could have figured out that dumb as a rock and square were not the same, you know, the same personality trait.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Getting rid of the stretcher obstacle course was obviously the best choice. That was just too silly. Entirely too silly. And it lost the intensity of Wayne's escape, quickly turned into the threat of death in the cliffhanger. Yeah, besides the budgetary constraints, it would have really detracted from the cliffhanger scene, I think. You know, it'd have all this comedy bit, and now he's headed for a cliff. And, you know, the whole rolling down the road is supposed to be intense, and we're worried about him. And, yeah, just too much comedy relief would destroy the tension.
Right, right. You know, cutting away to different things can create tension, but not when those things are all meant to be comedy relief.
Mm-hmm. Semple was pretty insightful about how Robin should be written, specifically the way he's supposed to function as a fully thinking second half of the Bat team, and should not be used for stupid sight gags, like the suggestion that he follows Batman on a bicycle. If the bicycle bit had happened so early in the series, I think he means, I'm certain most writers after that point would have turned Robin into the equivalent of a child just jumping around with a cape and making no adult-level contributions of his own.
Right. Yeah, I completely agree with Batwing Tornet on this. It's remarkable how much this episode taught us about Semple's view of Robin. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, not the episode, but rather the rewrites, the draft, and then the what became of Robin's character in the rewrites after that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, if the bicycle bit had gone through, the Robin on the show might have become more like the Lego Batman Robin.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of an airhead.
Super naive.
So, now, on to comments about episode 164, The Curse of Tut script show. The thread on the board started off with Robin Boy Blunderer with a rant against Batman v Superman, which we won't read here, but he points to a YouTube video where footage from Batman 66, the George Reeves Superman, and Linda Carter Wonder Woman is used, seems to be set to the soundtrack of a Batman v Superman trailer. I'm going to include that video in the show notes.
It's a lot of fun to watch. Somebody really did quite a suture job on those three different shows.
Yeah.
So here's email. I know this is from the Batman 66 message board from High C.
Yeah.
I tend to disagree with your premise that Bono is doing a goodly amount of ad-libbing here. Remember, this character was not written specifically for him. Semple was very protective of the show at this point, and although Buono had done six episodes of 77 Sunset Strip and thus was familiar to Horwitz, I'm not sure Semple would allow that much leeway to Horwitz Buono. And Semple seemed to have Dozier's ear more than Horwitz at this juncture. Just my two cents. I'm not saying he didn't do any, just perhaps not as much as you're saying. I think Bono did more ad-libbing later when the likes of Charles Hoffman and Sam Strangis in the night, were calling the shots. That was High C's joke, not mine, by the way. My guess would be Bono did influence the changes, as Semple saw his line readings and was adjusting on the fly and on the set to reflect what he was bringing to the table. And maybe the two did consult. But I find it hard to believe on his first shoot on a new show he was just changing stuff with wild abandon. Later, yes, but not this time. later edit by High C, it just occurred to me that Semple likely was still in Spain, so he wasn't on set. Oops, my bad. So a more likely scenario is that Buono and Horowitz were discussing potential script tweaks together. They had a prior working relationship. Remember, as experienced as Buono was at playing larger-than-life villains, he was still a working actor who was not a Dozier hire, we don't think. Thus, the goal, as always, is to do the best job you can to get invited back.
Okay. Then Danny Cool says, that's not the sense I come away with at all. Buono's line delivery of, you're a twit, etc., seem much more off-the-cuff to me. I don't think he sat down and planned it with Horowitz or anyone else. It doesn't sound like anything that Semple had in his other scripts either, for that matter. No proof, possibly just wishful thinking on my part, but I think this is all 100% Buono. And there was some more back and forth between High C and Dan about ad-libbing, and then Paul responded to the discussion.
Right. So I'm just going to read my entry here from the 66 message board. I think it's important to recognize that improvisation or ad-libbing in film and TV production rarely refers to a completely spontaneous take, one in which an actor embellishes or changes a line of dialogue or some stage business, then makes it to the final cut of the program or movie. Though we all know that rehearsals for weekly TV series in the 60s were cursory at best, they did indeed rehearse a bit to check lines as well as to consider framing and editing options and so forth. If improvisation happened, it happened during the rehearsal. And if the director and/or producer liked the change an actor suggested, perhaps at the director, line producer, or script supervisor's suggestion, if a line sounded off or the comic rhythm wasn't working as written, etc., if the director and/or producer liked the change an actor suggested, this change would be written into the shooting script, and camera angles and coverage would be adjusted accordingly, so there'd be no surprises during the actual shooting. Thus, if Buono improvised You're a Twit, for example, he likely did so during a table read or a pre-dress run-through. The powers that be liked it, and hey presto, it became an official part of the shooting script, even if it never turned up in the typed drafts or the final. The spontaneity of such a change happened long before the cameras rolled, it's true, but that wouldn't change the fact that it was indeed improvised in the first instance. As I suggested above, Buono may or may not have been the brain behind You're a Twit, but it wouldn't surprise me if he were. If so, that talent for improvisation may have suggested to the creative and executive staff that Buono could be trusted to push against the script even harder in future Tut offerings.
Yeah, now I think I didn't even realize this.
Right. Mm-hmm.
When I think of ad-libbing, I think of Robin Williams. And mm-hmm. I think Robin Williams, I was led to believe anyway that they just turned the camera on him and stuff came out. funny stuff came out, from Mork right. and Mindy on.
Mm-hmm.
But, and maybe that's what a lot of people on the board are thinking of too when they think of ad-libbing. I don't know.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, I think Robin Williams is a pretty special case.
Mm-hmm.
He was a stand-up comedian, and maybe Buono had done, some stand-up on stage as well before this. I don't know. I know that he, he did some comedy records,
mm-hmm.
after King Tut hit. But I'm thinking of someone like Robert Altman, who would rehearse his actors in ideas for a script, and then he would have the script supervisor and maybe other staff members as well write down or record what was being improvised. And then he would put together a script based on what the actors improvised so that it felt more like it was improvised down the road. So this is how he made MASH. This is how he made, even The Player, I think, has a certain amount of that kind of improvisation. But it's improvisation that's somewhat controlled. It is improv. It is ad-libbed. But then it becomes part of something that's more like a set script. So I don't know which is the case here for certain, but I would guess it's more conservative, particularly since Dozier, had such tight purse strings and wanted to make sure that things were, clipping along and that his, productions were as predictable as they could be. I mean, predictability is almost impossible to enforce when you're putting together a sitcom, but you try to do the best you can. So it would seem to me that with that tight a leash on the show, that if there is improv going on, it would need to be the kind that I'm suggesting.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And we end as we began with Bat-Winged Hornet. Another fascinating show, guys. Listening to the way a script was so different than the film version always gives a different perception of how the series unfolded. And what's sort of funny is that the original scripts often play better than the aired episode. I agree that Semple wanted to present Robin as an independent mind rather than a wish fulfillment character for children. By 1966, comic book Robin was pretty independent and founded the Teen Titans in 1964, so he was not like those endless "we's from the neighborhood" East Coast boy characters seen in more than a few 1940s comics.
Yeah, Simon and Kirby's Newsboy Legion, I'm looking in your direction.
TV Robin was a detective second only to Batman, and clearly so far above the skills of the GCPD.
No comment.
While I've never disliked teen sidekicks, well, the better sidekicks, I never appreciated producers creating kid characters operating from the belief that children needed to see themselves in the character, as if they could not appreciate or imagine being the adult hero. The best kid or teen sidekicks were the kind who held their own in the adult world and were climbing the ladder toward being an adult hero.
Mm-hmm. I think what Bat-Winged Hornet is hitting on is exactly why it was okay with me to be Robin to a certain degree. No, actually it wasn't. I was always Batman and I made you be Robin.
Well, yeah, so you wanted to identify with the adult hero. I think we both did, but deferred to you more often than not.
because I cried if you didn't.
Although I was listening back to our episode from a couple years ago where we talked about The Wrong Earth, and that was also the episode where we presented one of our Batman radio shows from the 70s, and I noted that in the first episode, which we didn't play because of poor sound quality, you had been Batman, but in part two, I was Batman. So we did trade off a bit.
Yeah, and I think that was in part acceptable to me because Burt Ward was Robin, or, you know, the kind of Burt Ward Robin that we got from the show was someone who could be trusted, someone who was, you know, climbing the ladder, as Bat-Winged Hornet puts it, toward being the adult hero.
Okay, so for our next episode, I put it up to the patrons, and they voted, and we had a tie for first place. So it comes down to us to break the tie anyway. So
what Tim's going to read one version of the podcast. I'm going to read the other one simultaneously, and we'll be in left or right channels, right? No, that's not what we're doing.
No, I don't think that would go over very well.
I suppose you're right.
So here's what we're doing next time. So as we all know, with Batman and the Green Hornet, Greenway Productions had a fledgling superhero universe going. We can call it the Dozierverse. But there were some other comics-based shows that Dozier produced that didn't see the light of day in the 60s. Dick Tracy and Wonder Woman. What was filmed is on YouTube, and we also got documents related to these shows from the American Heritage Center in Laramie. Ooh. So we'll be talking about those next time, and also the treatment that we mentioned a few episodes back for Mr. Zero. An idea which never made it to film, as far as we know, but it might be the reason why the Batman villain's name was changed from Mr. Zero, as it was in the comics, or in a comic, to Mr. Freeze.
Excellent.
Yeah, so we've got a lot of ground to cover next time. But nothing is very long, so I think we can fit it all in.
We'll certainly do our best. I don't think we're going to have any more 3-hour episodes like we did back when we were... they've never made it quite to 3 hours, did they, even when we were working on the 40s serials?
I think our longest one was that one about... the first one with Ad Lib Alerts of Victor Buono. Yes. I think that one got almost to 3 hours, just short of it. Or as I like to say, it was, 10 minutes shorter than Avengers Endgame?
Never let it be said that we ruin our podcast episodes by not exhausting the material.
Okay, so we'll be back with that in 2 weeks at the same Bat RSS feed. Check the show notes for the message board thread about our Curse of Tut script episode, Bobby Valentin's Batman's Boogaloo, and the Batman v Superman trailer featuring Adam West, George Reeves, and Linda Carter. Batpoles at DeconstructingComics.com is the address to send us your Bat missives or any interesting Bat audio that we haven't used yet on the show. Thanks to Chris Cavanaugh for the Burt Ward interview you heard in this episode. We're on Twitter at Decon Comics, and recent Batpoles episodes are now available on the Deconstructing Comics YouTube channel. You can hear outtakes from this and every episode of To the Batpoles and vote for future podcast topics by supporting us at patreon.com/deconcomics. You can also help us out by shopping via deconstructingcomics.com/amazon, by sharing our episodes on your social media, and by subscribing to the show on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. And spread the word. Let all your friends who are Batman 66 fans know about the show. What you're hearing now is Bang Bang by the Joe Cuba Sextet, a big boogaloo hit in 1966. Next time, on the heels of Batman's runaway success and the year-long run of the Green Hornet, the Dozierverse stumbles. We look at Dick Tracy, Wonder Woman, and Mr. Zero. May your own TV scripts make it to air and be runaway hits. We'll see you in 2 weeks. To the Batpoles is a production of DeconstructingComics.com.